Καλησπέρα σας, κυρίες και κύριοι συνάδελφοι. Έχουμε την τιμή μαζί με τον συνάδελφο τον κύριο Κοτζή, καθηγητή της Αγγιοχειρουργικής στο Αρετέιο Νοσοκομείο και απερχόμενο πρόεδρο της Ελληνικής Αγγειολογικής Εταιρείας, να καλωσορίσουμε στην αίθουσα, στο Προεδρείο, την κυρία Γκέρμαν. Η κυρία Γκέρμαν είναι παλιά φίλη της εταιρείας, καθηγήτρια της Αγγειοχειρουργικής στο Πανεπιστήμιο Κλούς Ναπόκα της Ρουμανίας και είναι προσκεκλημένη μας φέτος να μας κρατήσει μια διάλεξη με θέμα τις εξελίξεις και ό,τι καινούριο υπάρχει από την πλευρά της αγγειολογίας και αγγειοχειρουργικής στο θέμα της περιφερικής αγγειοπάθειας. Θα παρακαλούσα την κυρία Γκέρμαν να έρθει στο Προεδρείο.
First of all, I want to thank you of all of you, and firstly, Professor Manesh, and all the members of the Hellenic Association of Management of Diabetic Food, because I am the representative of the Romanian Society for Angiology and Vascular Surgery, and I hope our collaboration will continue. We have a lot of plans, so I hope see you in Romania next time during our meetings. The next minutes, I would like to present you some of our results concerning our diabetic food management, pointing of conservative treatment, but not only conservative because I am vascular surgeon. Diabetes mellitus is a widespread pathology in the world population, you know, and the prevalence of diabetes for all age groups was 2.8% in 2000, but it estimated to grow up at a very higher level and 4.4% in 2013. Which is more important, it's very simple sentences. Every 30 minutes a limb is lost due to a landmine, but every 30 seconds a limb is lost due to a diabetes. It's a very true sentences, and what you can do for reducing this risk. The complications of diabetes mellitus, it's retinopathy, neuropathy, arthropathy, nephropathy, but atherosclerosis are the major causes of morbidity and mortality. Peripheral vascular disease in lower extremities varies from asymptomatic to critical limb ischemia, and vascular disease in diabetic patients provokes ulcers and gangrene, finally leading to amputation or even death. 25% of patients with diabetes develop an ulcer in their life. Most authors mention diabetes as an important risk factor in the development of critical on chronic limb ischemia and consequent amputation. The amputation is a principal risk factor. It is important to perform surgical and medical treatments for diabetic patients with lower limb ischemia. So it's a complex treatment, a team and multidisciplinary specialist you need for this. In the next slides, I would like to present three parts. One of the parts is a consequence of neuropathic ulcers, and the neuropathic ulcers give us a lot of patients with complications. In the past 5 years, we treat in our department 324 patients with diabetic food. And you categorize and you group these patients in 5 groups. The first is with osteomyelitis of the distal phalanx, produced by super infection of neuropathic ulceration, consequence of the hammer deformation of the fingers. Sometimes the hammer deformation fingers is the cause of this osteomyelitis. What can you perform? You made the excision of neuropathic ulceration in superficial, a curettage of affected bone tissue, only the curettage in, on the distal phalanx, and soft tissue necrectomy. Here you have one of example. In this case, edema is one of the most underemphasizes clinical findings. So you don't need edema, but edema is present and may play a vital role in healing. Arterial evaluation you performed before, and it's non-invasive, firstly, a Doppler ultrasound, and the pressures, the distal pressures, relying on two pressures alone may lead one astray in predicting healing in patients with severe arterial occlusive disease. So you evaluate before the patient, before you perform the soft necrectomy or excision of and curettage of ulcers. The second category is use osteomyelitis of the distal phalanx associated with distal interphalangeal septic arthritis. In this case, you perform incision on the dorsal face of the finger, enucleation of the nail because the distal phalanx is compromised, isolation and excision of the distal phalanx, the interphalangeal joint and the distal extremity of the middle or proximal phalanx in the case of the hallux. A necrectomy of soft tissue with or without secondary suture. So the interphalangeal joint is affected. The third group, the proximal interphalangeal septic arthritis caused by supernatant ulceration resulting from the hammer formation of the fingers. In this case, you make an incision on the dorsal face of the proximal interphalangeal joint, isolation and extirpation of the affected joint, epiphysis of the corresponding phalanges and tendinous formations, and of course, necrectomy, drainage, and suture. The fourth category is compromise of the entire bone skeleton of the finger, but without affecting the metatarsophalangeal joint. So you go from distally to proximally, and now you have interphalangeal joint compromise. You perform an incision on the dorsal face of the finger, isolation and excision of the diseased bone structure while preserving the proximal epiphysis of the proximal phalanx, extirpation of capsular ligament formations, soft tissue necrectomy drainage, and with or without suture, secondary suture. But the key is preserving the proximal epiphysis of the proximal phalanx. You have here an example in which you preserve a part of distal phalanx because you have an osteoarthritis of the finger 3 and 4 with skeletal bone extirpation and soft tissue presentation. It's a false finger. The fifth category in which you have another subcategories, fifth subcategories, you have the metatarsophalangeal joint compromise, the consequence of neuropathic plantar ulceration. And this situation can be encountered along with damage to the entire bone skeleton of the finger. In this case, you made an incision on the dorsal face of the prolonged finger at the metatarsian level to proximal, the isolation and extirpation of the whole bone and metatarsophalangeal joint together with long distance ligament formations, and of course, necrectomy, drainage, and suture, secondary suture. But the extirpation of whole metatarsophalangeal joint is the key of this situation. The second subcategory with injury of the proximal phalanx, the incision on the dorsal face of the prolonged finger with isolation and extirpation of interphalangeal joint 1, proximal phalanx 2, head and metatarsophalangeal joint. So you need resect in healthy tissue. The third subcategory is with affection of the proximal phalanx and proximal phalanx and or distal interphalangeal septic arthritis. Incision on the dorsal face is prolonged so metatarsian finger, isolation of phalanges 1 and 2, and interphalangeal joints, isolation of the metatarsophalangeal joint and their resection with only half of the distal phalanx, soft tissue nephrectomy drainage with or without secondary suture. The fourth subcategory in which the metatarsophalangeal joint is compromised is stand alone. So you made an incision on the dorsal face of the foot corresponding to the metatarsophalangeal joint, isolation of the joint and only resection of this joint, metatarsophalangeal joint, with metatarsal head and proximal epiphysis of phalanx 1. Soft tissue nephrectomy with or without suture, and you have here an example in which the metatarsophalangeal joint was compromised and you perform only the excision of this joint with head of metatars and proximal part of the phalange, first phalange, and with good results and the healing of this ulceration of the diabetic foot. And finally, the fifth subcategory on this ulcer and metatarsophalangeal joint compromise is with massive destruction of metatars. In this condition, you need a resection of the metatarsian is in ineffective macroscopic tissue in healthy tissue. So is the fifth subcategory and five category of ulceration in a neuropathic situation due to these circumstances. Another peculiar situation is a Charcot foot. In the Charcot foot is a complex disease. An neuroosteoarthropathic foot is a condition affecting the bones, joints, and soft tissue of the foot and ankle, characterized by inflammation in the earliest phase and no infection. So in the first, you have a classification, is Holtz classification in four stages. The goal in the treatment of Charcot foot is to achieve a plantigrade stable foot that is able to fit into a shoe and to also prevent a recurrent ulceration. Recommended treatment for Eichenholz stage 0 is frequent follow-up with serial radiographs because the diagnosis is performed through a radiograph, MRI, or indio scan. You have here an example of Charcot foot stage 0 in which you have the inflammation and the diagnosis, the differential diagnosis with infection is very difficult. You need to elevate the foot and to wait, and if the hyperemia is disappear, is a Charcot foot, is now is infectious. You have here also example with MRI sagittal sequence in which you can show the patchy bone marrow edema in the calcaneus talus distal tibia and the anterior tarsus and the swelling and hyperemia of the foot. It's a nurse, 60 years of nurse with Charcot foot. In the Eichenholz stage 1, Charcot foot is successfully treated with immobilization and non-weight bearing in a total contact cast. In stage 2 is a subacute phase, a coalescent phase, is typically treated with protected weight bearing with a total contact cast or a molded total contact polypropylene ankle foot orthosis. You have here a lot of models. For stage 2, you prefer till here total contact cast and not this. This is for stage 3, chronic reconstruction is custom inlay shoes. You prefer in this situation. In stage 3, if the patient has a no plantigrade foot or recurrent history of ulceration, you perform debridement, exocestomy, correction, or fusion with internal fixation may be an option. This internal fixation is performed by orthopedists. So you have here only an example with supple construct with intramedullary screw fixation in stage 3 of Charcot foot. How is Charcot foot diagnosed? Because is sometimes the specialists know about Charcot foot, but general practitioner or another specialist confuses this disease. This is hot, this is inflamed foot. It looks like this on this inside, the bone are compromised, and finally the bones get soft, they start to fuse with each other and to cause deformity and ulceration of the foot. So you go through these neuropathic lesions in which the nerve decide don't work. So if the nerves decide stop working, you have lots of small injuries in which the patient develop the ulceration. But you have another side of the diabetic foot, the angiopathic foot, in which you need to perform more different and another types of interventions like bypasses. The bypass versus angioplasty for severe ischemia of the leg is open bypass versus catheter-based treatment. The open bypass was associated with improved survival and the trend of improved amputation-free survival comparing to catheter-based and open surgical approaches. Of course, early mortality, early major adverse cardiovascular event rates seem relatively similar in two procedures, open and endovascular, but wound-related and other major complication as is length of initial hospitalization is longer in open procedures. If you choose distal vessel, you have peroneal pedal or plantar, but you prefer dorsal pedis artery. The most frequent site in my experience for distal bypass surgery is common femoral artery in 43% of cases, peroneal artery, and after that, tibial posterior artery. And as outflow artery, tibial posterior artery was selected most frequent in 37%. And reversed saphenous grafts are used most frequently because you need a long distance, small diameter, and a good biocompatibility. Additional procedures such as endarterectomy, two-end metatarsal amputations, fasciotomies, or skin grafting were required in 47% of the operation. You have three examples with obstruction of the popliteal artery in the third portion without distal vascularization. It was stenting. This patient was stenting in vascular department by our colleagues. And after stenting, you have a flow, popliteal and tibiotruncal flow, peroneal and posterior tibial artery was repermeabilized with good results and wound healing at in the peripheral region. Another situation is a 65-year-old man with diabetes and peripheral arterial disease, common superficial femoral artery obstruction with repermeabilization, and common arterial obstruction. It was double stenting. After that, those good results and repermeabilization and distal revascularization. You can see here anterior tibial artery, tibiotruncal trunk, peroneal artery, and posterior tibial artery with good results and with healing of the distal ulceration in 6 weeks. And here you have a patient with obstruction of the popliteal artery in the third portion. And on this patient, you perform an open procedure and distal bypass popliteo pedal, popliteo pedal bypass with reversed saphenous vein graft. And with good results and healing of the distal lesion, this amputation of the fingers was performed before our intervention in other services. So you ensure the good condition for healing, and here you have a final result. Management of foot and extremity wounds was performed with negative pressure wound therapy or all the another procedure. And many patients in Rutherford's classes 4 and 5 need, after evaluation and conservative treatment, primary amputation. Role of the podiatrist in diabetic limb salvage is very important. In a multidisciplinary team for diabetic limb salvage, podiatry is a specialty that is licensed in the diagnosis and treatment of pathology of the foot and ankle in many countries, but not yet in Romania. The treatment includes both conservative and surgical modalities. Understanding the biomechanics is the key for the podiatrist. Sometimes the podiatrist need to perform digital amputation, but conclusion, lower limb ischemia is a serious event in patients with diabetes mellitus. The consequences may include increased mortality and morbidity, and however, distal arterial revascularizations are considerably effective procedures. The reduction in amputations among diabetic individuals is encouraging, and it's real now. The results presented here indicate that it's beneficial to adopt a multidisciplinary approach optimized for screening and treating complications like to diabetes. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Gherman, for the very nice lecture. Will you accept any questions from the audience? Okay, are there any questions from the audience, please? Professor Papanas, please.
Professor Gherman, congratulations, and thank you very much again. We're all very grateful to you for having honored our meeting twice, last year and this year, and we hope to have you again with us in the future. No, it's not the last, it's just this one. So thank you again. I was just wondering, the big progress that you have shown in distal vascular surgery is admirable. However, I wonder if improvement in the network between academic specialists in surgery and GPs, and you are aware that I was in Bucharest in October in a GP general podiatry meeting. So to cut a long story short, I wonder how you can improve and what you have to tell us about improving the network of patient referral from GP and podiatry to your centers of vascular excellence. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Papanas. Thank you very much for your question, because your question haven't yet too complex response. So you have yet problems with all the collaborations. You try to inform the general practitioner about this disease, about the diabetic foot disease, because it's very important. But sometimes they are very busy, there are a lot of problems, they haven't the idea to confer the patient to our department. So you have patients with diabetic food, which ask for a consultation in dermatology, another consultation in neurology. They lost time, and disease is severe. It's more severe. So for distal bypasses, we need very well diagnosed patients and very well specialist. Sometimes we lost patients and you need to perform primary amputation, but it's not a rule, it's an exception. Thank you.
Any other question? Okay. Thank you very much again, Professor Gherman. Συνεχίζει το πρόγραμμα.